Here we go. Hello, science enthusiasts. Welcome to Science Chat. If you're listening to Twitter, hello. We are quadcasting to Twitter Spaces, Clubhouse, Wisdom, and LinkedIn Audio. So hello to everybody listening from all of the different platforms. Tonight, our guest is George Hrab. George, you'll find out pretty quick. Maybe you already have. George is quite the jokester, an accomplished musician, and has a podcast of his own, and is deals with skepticism and the skeptical movement. So I'm really excited to talk to him today. I'm a longtime listener, first time talking in real life. Okay, back to the show. Thanks, George. That just kind of sets the tone for the people on the other platforms that are listening in via the quad chat. So where are you calling into the show from? Where are you in the world?
First off, you know, if you're going to use words like jokester, I mean, I might have to get out of here. I'm not sure. Just language, you know, just okay. Be careful. You're really pushing the boundaries.
Jester?
On Twitter Spaces, no less. Would you jester? Jester? No, I wouldn't. Jester's the hat's too silly.
Okay.
I wouldn't jester either.
Comedian.
It's all good. It's all good. I'm just being silly. I am Twitter spacing. Is that the active verb for what we're doing?
It is today, sir.
I am Twitter spacing from the lovely Bethlehem, Pennsylvania, the Christmas city, home of Music Fest, which is about to start in 3 days, which is very exciting. The largest free music festival in the Western Hemisphere is about to start. 9 days of 500 free acts of music and lots of peeing in front of my door. It's fantastic.
I was listening to one of your, did you chat about that on your latest podcast episode, this big musical festival?
I believe I did. It's my 30th festival. I moved in Music Fest week of back in August of 1993. And this is my 30th festival, 29th year, 30th festival, which is very exciting. It's kind of neat to see how the city has grown, how the festival has grown, and how the varieties of fried dough have expanded in ways that you just cannot imagine.
So when you were at one of these music festivals, do you have a guilty pleasure of like a super bad treat that you get? Like, is there, or can you not control yourself and just like whatever's in front of you, you're going to get?
Oh yeah, no, it's you kind of, there's like a day or two that you allow yourself to just sort of go to town. The way I justify it is because it's a free music festival, in essence, the food pays for the artists. So yes, you are paying $11 for a cheeseburger, but essentially half of that is going to the music. So that's kind of cool. So you think I'm actually doing good here by having these $9 fried Oreos, which, by the way, is the taste of the apocalypse. If you ever wanted to wonder or were curious as to what the apocalypse actually tastes like, it's fried Oreos that are dunked into a batter and then deep fried. And they're just, you know, they give you like three of them in this little plate, this little like paper plate. And you think, just three? Really? That's it? I'm paying $9 for three. And you get through about 1 3/4 and you just want to nap until Thanksgiving. It's fantastic. It's absolutely this molten deliciousness. The cream just turns into this kind of, it's almost like a sinful dance that's happening inside your face. And then the chocolate just has its own sort of molten-y goodness to it. And then the batter, it's just, yeah, and they'll fry anything. We've done fried Snickers. We've done fried Coke. That's a fantastic one. Fried Coke. You think, what is that about?
There's some next level science going on right there.
Absolutely. The gastronomical magic that's going on with fried Coke. It's just batter that instead of using either, seltzer or water, they use cola, they use Coke. And so you're just eating batter. It's just, you've given up. You've said, I'm done. I'm done. What else is going to happen to me? I'm literally just going to eat a plate full of batter. And it's kind of fantastic.
We have a comment in the chat on the bottom right-hand side. There's a little chat bubble. So that's people that they can kind of chat along with the conversation. It's like on Facebook Live, right, the little chat feature. Somebody said anything can be fried. And that is true. I've had deep-fried Oreos, George, at the local fair that we have in Alberta, Canada. The first one's pretty good, but I have to say the third one doesn't necessarily taste but like the apocalypse. It's more like regret for me.
Well, sure.
But
you know, you have to lean into it, though.
Yeah.
It's all we have anymore is just acknowledging the feelings we're having and leaning into them and saying, one more bite. One more bite might turn it around. It might turn it around. I'm holding out hope that one more bite of this absolute caloric monstrosity is going to turn around. I had a thing a couple of years ago. It was wonderful because the literal name of the stall was Giant Donut.
What?
It wasn't like Fred's Giant Donut or like Mississippi Giant Donut. It was just called Giant Donut. And let me tell you, the name was perfect.
Okay.
It was essentially, it was like a travel pillow. You know, the thing that you put on your neck to prevent yourself from, you know, like.
No.
Yeah. Yeah. It was essentially that. And let me tell you, Jason, it was perfection. It was perfection. It was so good.
How did you eat that much fried dough and not get sick?
I literally, the day before, I had done a triathlon. So it doing it as well. So it was like, okay, I did the thing. Now I'm going to have Giant Donut. And it was only $5 too. I think it was the best deal at Music Fest that year. And I don't know if they ever came back. I don't even know if it actually was real. It might've just been in my head. It might've been some kind of weird sort of post triathlon fever dream that I had.
Yeah.
But, oh my God. Worth it. It was totally worth it.
I feel like that's something from the complex stresses on your body after a triathlon. You dream about it, but it's actually your pillow. You're actually eating your pillow at night and not the giant donut. So
that's what happened, right? And yeah, oddly enough, I can't find any of my cushions anymore, but that's fine.
So we have you here as a guest on Science Chat, and you're such a unique guest in the fact that you do deal with science and skepticism. So I think that's what we'll talk about first before we get into music. The first thing is I'd just like you to talk about your podcast. You have this really fun podcast, and however you'd like to chat about it, go ahead. Now the floor is yours.
I'm going to do it in French, if that's okay.
Oh, well, Chris understands French. I just shot a video today about how dogs understand different languages. Not necessarily like they understand them, but they know it's a different language.
Oh, so. Yeah, absolutely. And do you know that cows have accents?
Yes, depending on where they are in the world.
Like a lot of animals have accents, but cows in particular tend to sound like their handlers. So if they're being milked by Canadians, they will have a certain Canadian bovine accent.
Yeah, they go moo.
Yeah, yeah. they're really funny. Apologize. sorry. Ooh. But or, you know, in Argentina, the cattle have a different moo because they're sounding more like they're. Isn't that fascinating?
It's very cool. Yes. Yeah.
It's absolutely cool. Yeah. The podcast started 16 years ago, which I can't quite fathom.
That's where I'm at. That's incredible.
I don't know if that's the correct word, but there is a word that is appropriate, and I will find it one of these days. I started it just sort of on a whim. My best friend is visually impaired. He has retinitis pigmentosa, so he lost his vision at 27, and so for him, audio was everything. Obviously. And 16, 18 years ago, he said to me, listen, I have one word for you. It's not plastics, but it's another word, P word, podcasting. I said, what's podcasting? So well, it's this thing. It's like an audio magazine. You can listen to. It's all I listen to anymore. It's great. You should do one. You should check them out. First off, you should send your music to some of these and you should do one. I was like, okay. So I sent my music to a couple podcasts. They actually did play it. I started a radio show for a summer here in Bethlehem at a local college radio station. When all the students were gone, they opened it up to community members. So just as an experiment, as a laboratory to work on bits for what would be my podcast, I spent the summer, 2 a.m., like 11 to 2 on Tuesday nights.
Oh my goodness.
No one listened, and it was great because like no one was listening. No one cared. I got to experiment, try some different things. I recorded everything. I listened. I made notes. And then that fall, I started the show and never intending it to be a science thing, a skeptic thing, never intending it to be primarily for that audience or that audience would find me or that audience even existed. I wasn't even aware. It was just, let me talk about stuff I'm interested in. Let me talk about music. Let me talk about comedy. Let me talk about science. Let me talk about relationships. Let me talk about food. Let me talk about giant donuts. Let me talk about whatever I need to talk about. And somehow people found it and started listening. And then kind of the skeptic thing, which is another story I can get into if you'd like. But that kind of came. So it was never this idea of, oh, let's do a science podcast, or let's do a, it's like, no, let's just do something that maybe my blind friend will listen to. Maybe my dad will listen to, and I'll do 50 of these and then I'll move on. And I got to 50 and it was like, eh, this is kind of fun. And let me do another 50. And then I got to 100. And this week I'm working on show 774. So
wow. There you go.
Did you know that you can get featured for free in top tier outlets like Forbes, The New York Times, Business Insider, even if you're just starting your business? Hey friends, I'm Gloria Chow, former diplomat turned small business PR coach and host of the Small Business PR Podcast. Every day, small business heroes just like you are hacking their own PR, getting their story in front of a bigger audience, and positioning themselves as a sought after industry expert. And on the Small Business PR Podcast, that's exactly what I'll help you with every single week. Click on the show notes below or go to GloriaChowPR.com/podcast. That's Gloria, GloriaChowPR.com/podcast.
Well, I have to be honest, I got into listening to podcasts really late, like super late. Maybe 3 years ago, I started listening to podcasts. So, and it kind of went like, I found Kara's podcast, Talk Nerdy. And from that, I found the Skeptics Guide. And then you came on as a guest role. I'm like, who the heck is this guy? This guy's hilarious. So then I found your podcast. So you did a good job of explaining what it is. It's like a potpourri. It's like a variety show, right? Like it's
Basically, there's like three aspects. There's the, you know, life as a musician, as a working musician. There's life as someone who appreciates science and weird and interesting facts. And then there's someone who appreciates comedy. Those are kind of the three things. So it's music, science, comedy, not necessarily in that order or in those proportions even, but just things that interest me. And there's bits that happen on a regular basis. And then what I love is that it is so open-ended that if I want to just, you know, for my birthday, I tend to do a cover of an entire album. I just, okay, I'm going to do Dark Side of the Moon this year. All right, Dark Side of the Moon, here it is on piano, top to bottom. That's my episode for this week. Goodbye.
I love it.
Or I want to interview someone, not that I do that often, but... Or I'll do movie reviews or whatever. And people, you know, it's a very loyal, tiny audience. I'm very happy with that.
Good deal. So I do have to ask the second part of this, is the whole skeptical thinking science. I guess that's two parts. Like, one, why are you so passionate about science and skeptical thinking? Since you'd probably say first and foremost, you're a musician. And what got you? What got you down that path?
Well, I was raised Catholic. I'm a recovering Catholic. You know, I was an altar boy, and by the time I was 8 years old, it didn't make any sense to me. So that, you know, it's one of the best things if you want to really understand religion and get away from it, kind of get in the middle of it. You know, do a couple of church services where you see sort of behind the curtain on some level, read the Bible like cover to cover, and you'll be amazed at what's actually there. And it's kind of the best way to get away from religion is by sort of participating in it fully and wholeheartedly. My dad is a science teacher. He instilled in me a lot of sort of critical thinking and a lot of, I didn't even know what a skeptic was until I read a couple books after college and saw that term for the first time. And I thought, oh, that's kind of cool. That's interesting. You know, critical thinking. And the kind of like the not indoctrination, but my introduction to the kind of the community was a strange one, and it relies on the, I've told the story a bunch, but it all comes down to sort of saying yes. I was supposed to perform music at this convention in Atlanta called Dragon Con.
Oh, no way.
So Dragon Con is a wonderful, it's like 1,000 people get together for Labor Day weekend, and about 18,000 of them are dressed as Klingons. So it's fantastic. It's a wonderful thing. I was booked to go just like do a couple little musical performances. And now my fake little record company, you know, I self-publish all my albums and stuff. My fake record company is called Geologic Records. And I had a domain name called, you know, geologicrecords.net was my domain, you know. And I hadn't started the podcast yet, but I just had Geologic Records. And someone at the Dragon Con science track because you have these different tracks at DragonCon. You've got the, you know, anime track, and you've got the Sasquatch track, and you've got the Star Trek track, and you've got the cooking track. And so there's a science track. Someone on the science track must have seen that this guy from Pennsylvania who, you know, has geologicrecords.net as his domain is coming down to Atlanta. And so they got in touch and they said, hey, could you, since you're obviously a geologist, could you do a talk about like the age of the Earth and how we know the Earth is older than 6,000 years? Since you're a geologist. And I said, well, I'm not initially, my reaction was like, well, no, because I'm a drummer. But then I thought, well, wait a minute, let me, maybe it'd be kind of fun to do that. So I got in touch with them and I said, listen, as long as you're aware and full of disclosure, I'm not a scientist, but I'm a fan of science. And if I can do it, present it as a fan of science, would that be okay? And they said, sure. So I did this lecture about how we know the Earth is older than they say it is in the Bible. And I didn't, you know, without using carbon dating, what can I talk about? So I did my research and, you know, I found out about lake varves, you know, algae falls every year and forms these little things. You can get varve layers of 100,000, 200,000 years, dendrochronology, you know, the whole thing about tree rings go back about 30, 40, 60, 80,000 years. You can find these tree rings that go back. And presented this talk, and there happened to be someone in the audience from the James Randi Educational Foundation, which was a thing that was existed at the time. James Randi, who was a hero of mine, still is. They had a conference out in Las Vegas, and this guy approached me and said, "So you're a musician?" I said, "Yeah." He said, "Like, you're not a geologist, science guy?" I said, "No, I'm a musician. I do songs. I do stuff." He said, "Well, we have this convention in Vegas. We wanted to have something happen between speakers. Would you want to do like songs between speakers? Like, you know, between Christopher Hitchens and Penn and Teller." And I was like, yeah, hello. So I agreed to that. I went out to Vegas, did that for a couple of years. And then the guy that was the MC had been doing it for years. He retired and I kind of inveigled myself and got the MC gig. And then it just all sort of, you know, it's all by saying yes. It's all by saying like, I'm not a geologist, but I can totally do a talk about geology. Why not? And that's how I sort of got sort of introduced into the critical thinking circles. And then that's when I met the SGU at that second, I think it was the second time I was at the TAM, the amazing meeting out in Vegas, and became instant friends with them. Jay and I bonded over losing our pets. He had lost a cat. I lost a dog and cried within 20 minutes of first meeting each other. It was fantastic. We became instant brothers and haven't looked back since. And now I'm here talking to you. See how that works?
Yeah, that is a cool story. I think I knew, like, I knew bits and part, bits and bits of it, but not the whole thing. So I appreciate you taking time to paint a picture for everybody that's listening.
Yeah, it is the real power of sort of getting outside what you're comfortable doing. I know it's like a cliche to talk about that kind of stuff, but, you know, the things that tend to provide the most feedback, the most response, and the most kind of almost pleasure and profitability tend to be those things that are uncomfortable, that are challenging, that drive you to a point of like, can I do this? You know, I did a TAM talk a couple of years ago, having no clue what to talk about, but knew they were doing TAMX, TEDx talks here in the Lehigh Valley. And, you know, a close friend said, go do it. I said, what am I going to talk about? She said, I don't know, just go, you can talk about stuff, go figure something out, go do it. And it was, you know, and now I'm literally the president of the TEDx Lehigh River, which is the valley that I became just this past spring. I became a board member and then they voted me in and I'm the president of the TEDx, you know, going from like, can I do this? I don't know if I can do this, to being, and I still have no idea what I'm doing. And that's the other beautiful thing to anyone out there that's listening. Like, nobody knows what they're doing. Like, that's one of the things I've learned over the years is really like, nobody knows what works and what doesn't. When it comes down to it, you can sort of get better at things and you can get a decent idea of how things kind of work and how they should work. But for the most part, people that are successful, really, when they look back on it, can be like, I'm not exactly sure. I know this moment happened, and they were all important moments and I was in the right place, but why I decided to do that or why I didn't decide to do that, I'm not quite sure. And why it was received the way, like, nobody knows. And it's okay to have that kind of voice in the back of your head saying, you don't know what you're doing, because you just got to sort of, you know, plow through until literally, like, you know, here's a drummer talking to you know, you about science. What? How does that work?
I teach high school chemistry, George, and that is my favorite thing to tell kids. They're like, "What are we doing today?" And I'm like, "I have no idea. Why are we even here?" Or like, they'll be like, "What's happening in the lab today?" I'm like, "I don't know. There's no procedure. Let's go."
Well, but even beyond that, like being a teacher, you know, I have such a tremendous respect for teachers. I've never been a teacher. I'm from a family of teachers. My sister was a teacher. My mother was a teacher. My father was a teacher. I've never taught because I have such unbelievable respect for it that, like, if I was to ever be someone's bad teacher, that would just destroy me. And I know how much work is involved in doing it and the responsibility of it. But there is this unbelievable sort of mythos associated with the teachers in the teacher room at school are just as anxious as the kids.
They're scared.
They're just as clueless. They're just as, I don't know how I'm going to do this. What's going on? Oh my God, everybody hates me. What's good? It's like the same. It's the same thing, just slightly different clothing.
Yep. You
know, it's, and I love that. And I wish that was communicated more on some level, especially to kids, where it's like, yes, you have to respect your teacher. Yes, you have to appreciate that there is a person in charge and there's going to be a format to why we're doing this. But deep down, when you're dealing with those feelings of anxiety and those feelings of being lost and those feelings of, I don't know what the F I'm doing, like that is universal. And the guy that's in charge of the classroom is feeling that too. And it's okay. It's okay. You know, it's totally okay.
I make fun of the teaching where that happens, like trying to... There's points in high school where there's like little bottlenecks where it's really tough to get a concept across. And one of them is converting metric units, from a kilometer to a meter or from a kilogram to a gram. And sometimes kids go the other way and I make a big joke about it. So I'm like, okay, guys, this is a meter stick. How many kilometers are in a meter stick? And instead of dividing by 1,000, they times by 1,000. And some kid will say, there's 1,000 kilometers. I'm like, okay, so let's just think about that. So, yeah.
The old ballpark. The old ballpark, that was one of the best things a science teacher, I think I was in seventh grade. We had this idea of like the ballpark estimate. Like, okay, are you headed in the right direction? Let's think macro. Mm-hmm. Could there possibly be 1,000 kilometers in this stick? Let's think of the macro. Like, let's not even think about, you know, details, just the macro. And it's a great way. I mean, I saw a wonderful talk years ago about astronomical distances. You know, and it was like the way the speaker was presenting it was, it was so average and broad in terms of the numbers, you know. So he's like, okay, let's imagine like the nearest galaxy to us, and let's just say it's, you know, 1,000. We're gonna say it's a thousand, or whatever it was, you know. But he was using these broad terms, and it was so refreshing to not think like, oh, you have to know that it's 6,948, you know, AU or 10,850 light years from the, like, you don't have to know those things to appreciate and love the concepts. And you can do these large, you know, broad calculations that'll get you in the ballpark. That'll relay the idea of how vast the universe is, or how fast light travels, or how far away a certain celestial body can be. You don't have to know the details of it. You can bandy about figures and time and facts in generalities, and appreciate the magic of the science, appreciate the magic of the equations that are there in broad terms. It was so refreshing to just be like, you know, okay, the sun is, you know, 1 AU from us. What is that? Is it a million miles? It's 500,000 miles, or, you know, like, who cares? We're going to talk AUs. Okay. And it was just so great. It was so refreshing.
Studying English for work, school, or as a hobby. AI English Podcast is your one-stop shop to boost your English listening skills in daily and business conversations. Business articles, TV, movie, and book summaries Monday through Friday. Improve your listening skills 5 to 10 minutes a day with AI English Podcast. Listen on Spotify, Google Podcasts, Apple Podcasts, Amazon Music, or wherever you listen to podcasts.
Yeah, It is, yeah, an AU is an enormous distance, and I think that's why it's just easier to think of it as one than, what, exactly. than whatever it is, like 1.5 million kilometers or something. I forget exactly.
Even like light years. I mean, even light years, the idea of using that, you know, which we get, I think, inured to the actual distance of a light year, because when you stop and you go, wait a minute, this is light traveling for 365 days at... Yeah. At what, 980,000 miles a second? What is it? 180,000 miles a second?
Yeah.
Whatever that number is. But like, okay, that just get that in your brain for a second. Just try. We can't really understand these distances. We can't really understand this time. But we do the best we can. So yeah, an AU is great. A light year is great. You know, even something like a hemisphere. You know. Even the planetary distances, you can't sometimes quite fathom what they are, you know, especially now. It's like you get on an airplane and you can be in Europe in 6 hours from the East Coast. Like, that's just insane.
And if you go fast enough, you arrive before you left.
Well, yeah, there's that. There's that wonderful thing. I mean, I did a thing. I was in L.A. years ago for another one of these conferences, and I saw the sunset. I was on this aquarium on a pier, and I watched the sunset, and I had a flight that night at, you know, whatever it was, 9 o'clock or whatever, or 11. It was a red eye. So I went to the airport and I get the flight and I fly to New York. And as I'm landing in New York, the sun is coming up. And it was like, we had each taken a trip around our respective sides of the planet. And so I got to see within the span of 8 hours, I guess it was, something like that, because with the time change and everything, and then the flight, like a sunset and a sunrise, and it was this wonderful moment of appreciating technology and appreciating the infrastructure and appreciating the what could allow a human to have that experience, you know, for $500. just like to experience a sunrise and a sunset in 8 hours, that should be an unbelievably expensive thing that you couldn't even like fathom to do. And yet here it was, and I got a meal out of it too. So it's just that kind of stuff is amazing to me.
Well, using your same logic from the music festival, the meal was $500, but you got to see the sunrise and sunset.
Exactly. Well done, sir.
So let's talk music now, George, if you don't mind.
Sure.
You play a bunch of different instruments. I have just a couple questions about your life as a musician. First off, like, were you a kid that was big into music when you were young, or was there
that was everything. What really was tremendously formative for me, I mean, first off, I'm first generation Ukrainian. So if you know anything about Ukrainians, is if you get more than two of us in a group, we just kind of start singing. If you get alcohol inside more than two of us, you can't get us to stop singing, which is one of the reasons I don't drink, but that's another story. So song and singing has always been culturally a huge kind of component, you know, from Ukrainian scouts to Ukrainian school and all that kind of stuff. But I also went to a musical preschool, which was just so tremendously influential and cool. So before I was in kindergarten, I was in this Ukrainian musical preschool, and the whole day was built around music. We literally had these like staves of lines of music were drawn on the floor. So we would like be notes. We would stand where notes would be. So you would be like a G or an A or an F, or, you know, and these are three, 4 years old, you know? We did little productions, like little plays. So that was hugely influential. My dad, not only being a science teacher, he also on the weekends was a drummer in a band. If you knew a Ukrainian who got married between 1965 and 1990 and who lived in Pennsylvania or New York or New Jersey, pretty much my dad played their wedding.
Okay.
Pretty much, but like odds are, there's about a 70% chance that my dad played their wedding. And so he was playing on the weekends, and I just, you know, he was a drummer, so I became a drummer. And then when college became an option, it was like, oh, I could do this music thing. That would be fun to do. That would be interesting. And did that. So I got a degree in percussion performance, and that was it. And then my roommate was a guitarist, so he showed me a bunch of guitar things. And then years later, I started playing piano, and just it all kind of fomented together in its way. But music was always a big thing. I mean, I always liked performing, whether it was, being silly sketches at school or plays or whatever. But the band was cool because you got to be kind of in the pit for the musicals. So you weren't necessarily committing yourself to being in a full production of the musical. So you could still do sports. So I could do sports. I could swim. I could play baseball. I could play soccer. But I could still be in the pit band for the show. It was kind of the best of all possible worlds for me.
Not as intense. I know, as I said, I teach at a high school, and those drama productions are quite the productions, and the pit band kids don't work near as hard as the theatrical kids that are on like lights, like the production kids, not the actors. Sure. It's like the poor kids that are in charge of lights. They put in like 1,000 hours in a week getting ready because they're always on, always.
Yes. Yes.
So shout out to those kids. They absolutely just are wiped out the week before. Absolutely. And the week after. They're like, oh, we can't do any chemistry homework. I'm like, okay, it's fine.
That's right.
Go to sleep. Like, right. Is there an instrument that's your favorite? Like, you do play the drums, right? That's your main thing. But
yeah, drums, I'm school. I have a degree in that. So that was the breadwinner forever, but each instrument has its own, there's things that each instrument can do you can't, go into a coffee shop with a drum set and just play. I mean, you can, but you'll get a lot of dirty looks, but, sort of sit in the corner with a guitar is a wonderful thing, but I adore playing piano. I mean, again, I'm not a super proficient piano player or a guitarist, but I'm okay. And I just enjoy the puzzle of it. I mean, there's something about piano that once it finally clicked for me, it didn't click for me for decades. And then about maybe 6 or 7 years ago, it kind of clicked finally. And it was like, oh my gosh. And so that I can sit and play standards and sort of decode these beautiful songs that are these intricate puzzles. I just love it. I just love it. I could spend hours and hours, learning and playing tunes. Let alone writing. I just did for one of my birthday podcasts. I just this past month did the Elvis Costello and Burt Bacharach record from 1998 called Painted from Memory. And to really dive into these tunes and just pull them apart and learn them and then be able to perform them and realize what was going on inside them. It's like archaeology. I mean, at least my version of archaeology where you're peeling back these layers of compositional detritus. That's the wrong word. Compositional intention is what it is. Because you've got the lyrics, you've got the melody, and then you've got the orchestration, and you've got the chords, and it's like, oh my gosh, it's as ornate as any sort of Grecian frieze that you might find under a McDonald's that's been bulldozed. When they find these, they find these things. You have to take a toothpick and a toothbrush too, and slowly remove, whatever 800 years worth of gunk on top of it. And you realize the beauty that's within. And oh my gosh, it's just when it clicks like that. And when you're dealing with really wonderful, wonderfully composed pieces, like what's on that record, oh my gosh, it's a joy. It's a struggle, and it's like anything. It's an absolute torture sometimes. But the best results can come out of it because of the effort put into it.
Wow. Nice. That's cool. You're getting a lot of love from, I don't know if you see the photos of people in the room on Twitter, George. Sherry Grant, she runs a room, Twitter space is called Piano Avengers. Mm. So they take requests and they have different pianists that play. So shout out to Sherry. Uh-huh. Uh-huh. She was giving you lots of little heart emojis when you started talking about the piano.
Oh, so. Thanks, Sherry. Aren't major seven chords the best? Don't you love major seven chords with like a third in the root? Oh my God, it just fills my heart with chocolate. Oh, it's the best. Minor nine chords, man. Minor nine chords. If you use a minor nine chord the right way, it's so much better than just a minor chord. And then I'm just talking to Sherry right now, but she'll know what I'm talking about. It's like now that album that I did. It's covered in minor nine chords, which you just get this appreciation for that. that second that's in the chord. So like you take it, you take an A minor chord, right? Right. Which is like, you know, just a first, third, and the fifth, and you add the second, and it just gives you this lovely little crunchy dissonance that just makes it beautiful. And it opens up the palette for what you can do melodically with it. Oh, it's just the best. Just delicious. Sorry.
No, we're talking music. No, we talked before. I don't know if you're prepared or not, George, to play anything. We can do that at the very end if you'd like, or not at all. I don't know if you're.
I worry about the quality of it with the phone. That's all I'm concerned.
Sure.
I don't know if it's going to come across like.
It's okay. We can move on. It's all good. No pressure.
No, I'm happy with something. I just worry it's going to like the condenser and the phone. Once you get a guitar and a voice happening, you get this kind of thing, and I'm just worried it's going to sound like dog poop.
It's okay. No worries. I get it. Twitter Space is probably among the three different social audio apps has the worst quality audio. Yeah. So if we were on LinkedIn audio, I've listened to some musicians play on LinkedIn audio and it sounds like I'm at a bar. Like it's pretty good. Yeah. So just a heads up for the future there, George, if you're ever thinking to do this yourself again and play some music, think about the LinkedIn audio. It's just really, really good over there. So
that's cool. Okay, cool. Yeah. I tend to do stuff on, you know, I do YouTube live things and occasionally a Facebook live thing, which I know that's like such grandpa tech, but whatever, but
Facebook is coming back. The stats are the young kids are coming back to Facebook because it does like it's more geared towards business than some of the other ones. So
interesting. Okay, that's funny.
I brought Sherry up just because I have a lot of respect for Sherry and she requested. So normally we take questions at the end, but I'm going to let Sherry jump the queue. Did you have a question for George or a comment?
Oh, just really, really enjoying this conversation. And I actually have a little bit of science background. My dad is a science teacher. And I actually, after doing performance degree at university, I did a computer science degree as well. Probably not a lot of people know that, but it's wonderful. That complements each other.
Ooh,
and
Sherry, where are you from?
Correction, I am not running Life Piano Avengers. I'm one of the Lady Avengers, Anna Ranzit.
I'm sorry.
It's okay. But I play a lot of concerts about every fortnight these days. Thank you. Oh, my last concert was G minor concert. You were talking about keys. So that it might be of interest.
What was it? What was the piece?
Oh, all the pieces in G minor.
Oh, all the pieces in G minor. Did you Mozart, no, you wouldn't do it because it was just piano.
But. Not Mozart, but I actually played Haydn and a whole lot of pieces I wouldn't normally play, like Clara Schumann and Fanny Mendelssohn and Liszt and Chopin.
Oh, fabulous. My favorite G minor piece is the Mozart 21. It's such a heavy metal riff. Oh, it's so great. It's so great. Oh, okay. Lovely. Oh,
that can be the next request. Thank you.
Oh, please. Where are you from?
I'm from Auckland, New Zealand.
Oh, Auckland is lovely. Auckland is lovely. I was in Auckland for like a night years ago. I had a tour years and years ago. I did like six cities in 5 days. I was in Auckland for one. I played in a bookstore in Auckland. It was fantastic.
Nice. That's on my bucket list to go to New Zealand, Sherry.
Oh, dude, you must go. It is. I mean, Australia is wonderful, and New Zealand. If you can do those two, you know, like bundle them together if you can. But New Zealand is, you know, you're on the airplane, and you've just spent, let's say, a week in Australia, which is fantastic. It's just beautiful, friendly people, fantastic stuff. You're there. It's there. It's like the thing you've read about all these years. You're in freaking Australia. It's amazing. Sydney with the harbor and the koalas and it's amazing. And then you get on the plane and you go to New Zealand and you're flying into Auckland or you're flying into wherever you're flying into and you're approaching this island and you think like, wait, like how is that color green possible? How is that? I've never like this verdant welcome. As you approach and like the plane lands and you're just instantly in this overwhelmingly beautiful green, just lush thing. You're in it's like a Muppet that you're inside. It's just wonderful. And then again, people are incredibly friendly, yet like they don't take any crap from you at the same time. It's this beautiful balance of no pushovers, but just friendly. And then, you know, I got to see, you know, Mount Doom. You get to go see Mount Doom.
Yes. I didn't want to admit it, but that is the main reason I want to go there, is because of Lord of the Rings.
You're on a highway and it's like, oh, see that over there? You're like, yeah, that's Mount Doom. Oh, that's Mount Doom. Yeah, that's Mount Doom. Hello. No, it's just wonderful. Just absolutely wonderful. And then you go to the Weta workshop and then you do the other stuff and it's just, yeah, go.
Nice.
That and Galapagos. If you're ever in any kind of a decision that is pitted against the Galapagos, like even if it's like, you know, do you want the winning $1 billion lottery ticket, or do you want to go to the Galapagos? Pick the Galapagos. Okay. I'm like 100% serious. It was just, I did a 9-day boat thing in the Galapagos, and it was unbelievably magical and just beyond what it was supposed to be, which is crazy because you have your expectations of what the Galapagos are going to be is the freaking Galapagos, and it was beyond. It was absolutely beyond.
I am very jealous of my sister. She got married and had her honeymoon. No, she got married in Canada, but her honeymoon was in the Galapagos. So she has many, many photos that made many, many people jealous. So
lovely.
Well, okay. I've got one more question before we open up the floor to our guests. And I know you work with the SGU, which is the Skeptic's Guide to the Universe. And
Horrible people. Terrible egos. The writers that I have to sign to work with them, it's unbelievable.
So I know not everybody would know who the SGU is, but they're a big deal if you love science. And just like, that's very cool that you get to work with them. And this show is not about them. It's about you. And I was wondering if you could give us a couple tips from working with your own podcast and the SGU about critical thinking. Just what are some things that you you feel we could all do so we don't fall prey to pseudoscience or woo or stuff like that?
Well, first of all, you know, the SGU is a big deal even if you don't like science. So that's number one.
Yeah.
Let me say that. And let me, in all honesty, say the Novella brothers, you know, in particular, but also Evan and Kara, they are some of the finest, most generous and lovely human beings you could ever hope to work with. What I have learned from not necessarily even doing the show with them, but just having casual conversations with them, has been priceless. And I just am indebted to them forever and ever and ever. They are, what I adore about them is what you hear on the show is who they are. So we've literally had, you know, dinners like where it's the six of us. It's another, like, you know, Bob is talking about microtechnology, and, you know, Jay is mispronouncing words, and Steve is correcting everybody. And it's like, and I'm thinking like, this is why they're successful, because there is no artifice to it. There is professionalism, there is preparation, there is a ton of work, but there's no artifice, there's no characters there, excuse me. And their listeners realize this, and you can only hope that who you hear is who is there. You know, like, you always hope that that cool person, that, you know, that cool actor, that cool podcaster, that cool musician, you hope that that's who they are. And let me say unabashedly that who you think the SGU is, if you are a fan of theirs, is who they are, and even more so. And it's wonderful. Okay. That being said, the number one piece of advice that I can give in terms of how to think critically, and it's both, like many good pieces of advice, it's both the easiest and hardest thing to do. And the thing that you need to keep in mind is the time that you need to be most critical, the time that you need to be most skeptical, the time that you need to check and recheck and make sure that what you're presenting is correct, is when you want the piece of information you're presenting to be true. It's the hardest thing to do. confirmation bias is the thing that you, as a critical thinker, is the most, it's the biggest demon you have to fight, because it's so easy to find things that agree with you, whatever your standpoint may be on whatever issue, whatever topic it may be, you know, whether Picard is better than Kirk, you know, or whether vaccination is more important than non-vaccination. It doesn't matter whether it's trivial or some of the most important things you ever need. You can always find some kind of information to back up what you're thinking. And if you can't find some information to back up what you're thinking, you can usually find a reason to back up what you're thinking. And so that's when it's most critical to be able to stop and say, okay, this information makes me feel good. This agrees with my viewpoint. This reinforces my belief system. I really got to make sure it's right. I really, really got to make sure it's right. And again, it's the easiest and hardest thing to do. And when I started thinking that way, sort of really consciously, it really made a difference. Because then once you sort of do have confirmation that maybe your instinct was right, maybe your belief system is right, maybe your that thing that you like or that thing that you hate has a reason why you like it or hate it, or that piece of information is actually true, and you can back it up dispassionately and saying, yes, I know I my emotions are backing this up, but here's why this is also true. Boom, 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 boom. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Here's the points. Here's the reason. And yes, it happens to coincide with my thoughts, but that's not what's driving this engine. What's driving this engine is the critical thinking and the appreciation of the data that can then back it up. You know, mm-hmm. that's the primary thing that you need to do. And to realize that we can all think poorly. No one is immune. It doesn't matter what degrees you have. It doesn't matter how wealthy you are. It doesn't matter what your experience has been. It doesn't matter if you're a professional in the subject that is being discussed. Everyone can make mistakes. Everyone can fall prey to non-critical thinking, to non-smart thinking. It doesn't mean you're dumb. It doesn't mean that you're less than. It doesn't mean that you're evil. It just means that our brains are wired in such a way that there are plenty of opportunities that we can just think very poorly. My favorite example of this, which is I talked about in my TED talk, Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, who created Sherlock Holmes, like the most data-driven fictional character of all time. You know, Sherlock Holmes looks at a situation and says, what's real, what's not, what are we dealing with? These are the facts. He's dispassionate. He's written to be this machine of dispassionate facts. Brilliant. Well, Sir Arthur Conan Doyle thought the Cottingdale fairies were real. You know, he thought that the fairies that were taken by these photographs of these fairies that were taken by these girls in their backyard, he thought the fairies were real. His wife was a spiritualist who did spirit writing. She'd grab a board and a pencil and she would just start scribbling. And they'd be like, oh, obviously her hand was taken over by a dead person and wrote this message. You know, anyone is susceptible to bad thinking, even the creator of Sherlock Holmes. That's a thing to keep in mind, and you are just as susceptible as the biggest wackadoodle person that you might see on the internets. You are just as susceptible, not maybe as consistently susceptible, but there are moments that you can be as susceptible to non-critical thinking as that person.
That is a great point. I love that. Our account made a mistake. A while ago, we retweeted some fabulous space picture, and it turns out it wasn't real. It was a painting. A whole bunch of other people got duped, right? But it was so beautiful, and it was so cool. I just didn't even think twice about it. I was like, oh, man, that's so neat. And then I had a witty, like, dog kind of spin on it, because our account is, you know, communicate science through the eyes of dogs.
Right.
And it turned out it was a painting, and I was like, oh, so I had to delete it. Right. Of course I deleted it.
Okay. But you made a correction, you know, that's the thing is when new information was presented, you said, okay, no matter how much I love this painting and I love the joke that or the pun that I made, which was, I'm sure it was a zinger.
It was a good one.
you gotta go, well, all right, it's not, I can't, we can't do it. We gotta change it and we're gonna switch it. Sorry about that. And you correct it. And that's the beauty of critical thinking, of going like, oh, okay, no, I'm, boy, I had this wonderful conversation with a friend of mine who was traditionally conservative. He was sort of raised conservative. He's just an incredibly nice guy. And just, we had this conversation about homeless people. And I said, you know, there are a bunch of studies that have been done about how it's cheaper, you know, to just provide homeless people with apartments than it is, you know, just give them a place to live, than it is to wait until they're sick and they're in the ER. This is like, this has been done again and again and again. And he kind of looked at me and he was just like, yeah, but you're, you know, you're incentivizing laziness and you're, and it's like, that's okay. That's a valid point to make, whatever. I sent him a couple little studies in an article that sort of, it was a study that was done in California that intrinsically showed if you take people that are homeless, provide them with a space where just simple living, you know, like a simple apartment with a bathroom and a bed, you know, something, the majority of them within a year, like, had worked themselves out of their homelessness and had a job and had it provided this kind of cushion. And to his credit, he was like, you completely changed my look at this. You completely changed, like, which that rarely happens, by the way. Rarely can you convince someone of something. But since we're good friends and close friends, and he appreciates my perspective and he appreciates my sort of approach. And it wasn't like, no, you dummy, this is what is actually happening. I said, just, this is what, these are studies that have been done. And it's kind of fascinating. You would think that, yeah, this would incentivize people to not want to work or not want to work, you know, and it's the exact opposite is true. And to his credit, he was like, boy, you really opened up my eyes to this thing. This is neat. And I was talking to my other friends at work who believed what I believed, and like they were fighting back a little bit, and kind of, I thought, okay, that's how it works. Get some new information, you know, look at it, who's presenting it, how is it being presented, and then you can change your mind. And that's the beauty of being a human, is you can change your mind.
Mm-hmm. And having a close bond or a close relationship to somebody with new information too.
Hopefully. And again, yeah, that's no guarantee, because yeah, there's lots of other examples. It just doesn't feel that way to me. And I'm just going to, we're going to have to agree to disagree, which is like the worst phrase ever in all of humanity.
I do have to say my mind was changed quite drastically because I now love this cat that we have. So the people in the audience who follow Bunsen and Beaker know that we got a cat named Ginger. My son rescued the thing, and this cat is adorable. And before, I kind of like looked at cats with, you know, zero mm-hmm. emotion. And now I realize why people love their freaking cats, because they are adorable. So I just needed new evidence. I just needed new data of living next to a cat.
The cat is just waiting for you to die so we can eat your eyes, by the way. Just
well, here. I know this, but they also, yeah, when you pick them up, they make sounds like a little baby.
Yeah, absolutely. They're clever.
They are very smart. Yeah. George, is it okay if we take some questions from the audience, if anybody has some questions?
They have to be good ones, though. They got to be really smart.
Okay.
They will be. How could they not be? With your audience, how could they not be?
Kate, we've got a couple people requesting to come up. Now, again, during the question and answer question phase, you can ask a question from any of the social audio sites. We do vet you. So if we know who you are, you're going to come up right away. And if you're not familiar, we do kind of go through your profile to make sure you're not a troll. So you may not get right up to the stage. So I think, Indra, you're up here first, and then Ron's coming after. So Indra, go ahead.
Thanks so much, Jason and Chris, for holding this space. It's really entertaining. And George, I've been actually having quite a chuckle at a lot of things that you've been saying. So very entertaining. My question is, of course, it's movie related because that's what I do. I was wondering, and I was so curious actually, do you have a favorite movie because of the soundtrack? And I'll tell you what mine is after, but you need to tell me yours first.
Ooh, that's a good question.
Oh my gosh. Okay, I have a little, I mean, it's technically, I mean, this is a bit of a cheat. So I'll have to answer a couple different ways. But no, I mean, if we're going purely by soundtrack from a movie, I would have to say Stop Making Sense from the movie Stop Making Sense, which is the Talking Heads concert film. I don't know if concert films count, but that film that I saw when I was 12 years old absolutely floored me and threw me down the road of being a performer and adoring David Byrne and Talking Heads and all of that. So that soundtrack is an absolute milestone. I mean, it's not even a milestone. It's the cornerstone of the building of my life. That being said, Amadeus has a pretty gosh darn good soundtrack. Cause you know, that Wolfie, he could write a tune. He could write a tune that Wolfie could.
I love that choice.
Yeah. I probably in terms of like actually listening to that, that's really good. There's also the wonderful, wonderful soundtrack from Scott Pilgrim versus the World.
Oh, yes.
That's Ooh. Just.
Yes, George.
Because that's Beck mostly. Beck wrote most of those.
Yeah,
tunes,
Beck. Oh.
And it's just that film is just so that movie didn't make $1 billion.
No, it should have.
It's a crime.
My oldest son and I went and saw that movie when it came up. We were the only two people in the theater. And yeah. I was like, why aren't there a million people watching the show? It was so good. Sorry, George. I just can't believe somebody mentioned Scott Pilgrim versus the World in one of our spaces.
Oh, it's fantastic. And it holds up. I've seen it probably seven times.
Yeah, it does.
It completely holds up. And you see all these actors that like now have made complete careers outside of that.
Yeah, it's
like,
got Captain Marvel and Captain America.
Seriously. I mean, it's just crazy. You know, yeah, it's so that soundtrack is pretty happening.
Oh, okay, how about
yours?
Great.
What's yours?
Okay, so mine is, I'm taking a different tact. I do love classical music because I'm also trained as a classical ballerina. But I actually went with Guardians of the Galaxy.
Oh,
yes. Zoe Saldana, Ed Harris. Now, some of these songs like Hooked on a Feeling, Go All the Way, Ain't No Mountain High Enough. I mean,
sure.
The Sky.
Oh,
I mean,
my
I'm
God.
Just, there's so many more. I can't think of the other ones. But anyway, I think I did okay. just trying to remember those ones. But so, I mean, like the minute the movie starts, and my husband actually really enjoys watching this movie over and over again, as we do. And I can't help kind of just starting to dance into the lounge room as soon as I hear it.
That's fantastic. That's fantastic. You know what's kind of like that, too?
Oh, yeah.
Hello.
There you go, Indra.
Oh, yeah.
Sorry, George.
No, I'm just saying something that's kind of like that. Also, the Pulp Fiction soundtrack.
Ooh,
that
that's
was another
good too.
One. You know, it's just because it's got, funnily enough, the band that I was in played most of those songs too, sort of all the funk stuff, you know, the Jungle Boogie and Let's Stay Together. And then, you know, Son of a Preacher Man. It's like, so that's, you know, Quentin's obviously his Quentin, my buddy Quentin, by the way. Quentin Tarantino's use of music is so sort of superlative. But yeah, Guardians, excellent choice. Excellent choice, Andrew.
Thank you. Oh, I did have one last question. Jason, is it okay if I ask George one other question?
Sure, George, you got more time? You got another 10 minutes or so? Okay, sure. Yeah, go ahead, Indra.
Okay, this is just a pretty quick one. I was just curious because you talked about instruments, but you didn't talk about if you actually sing. So I was just curious if you also sing vocals.
Well, it depends who you ask, Indra. I think I sing, but yeah, I do sing. I have actually six albums, all available on iTunes, and a concert DVD, and I have a live album that I did. So yeah, I do actually sing. I try to sing as best as I can. I enjoy it very much. Yes.
Awesome. Thank you.
Indra, I put up in the nest, I don't know if you knew this, but, and George, you mentioned Dragon Con, our family cosplays. I was a cosplay guest a couple times at Comic Cons. So mm-hmm. We cosplay, our entire family cosplays as the Guardians of the Galaxy. Oh, so perfect. I built a 8-foot-tall Groot suit. My one son goes as Star-Lord, and then my other son is Rocket, and my wife goes as either Gamora or Mantis. Chris goes as Gamora or Mantis. And we have one of those portable speakers, and it blasts the Guardians of the Galaxy soundtrack as we go around the Comic-Con. So it is so fun, and we just dance around and have fun with people. So,
oh, my I love that. Loved it.
Thanks, Indra.
And shout out to George for bringing up Scott Pilgrim versus the World. I've got that DVD somewhere. I'm going to have to watch it again.
Mm-hmm.
I love the sound effects, too. It's like little...
Everything, it's
set in Toronto, Canada. You can't get any better than that. As a Canadian, yeah. I've got... Scott was wearing a CBC shirt. I was like, it's a CBC!
Right.
So, anyways, the Canadian thing. Okay, over to Ron. Noble Ron, go ahead.
Hi, thank you, Jason, Chris, for letting me speak. And George, I have a question in terms of music or the music industry in general. I know that you are a fan of intelligent musicians. You like David Byrne, like you mentioned, and I think you, if I'm correct, you like Frank Zappa.
Very much,
and,
yeah.
Yes, and Zappa recently, I actually watched YouTube videos of him just giving interviews, and it was just, he's by far the most intelligent musician I've ever heard speak on, you know, with the intelligence, but... I was just wondering, in terms of popular music now, and I don't know if you listen to popular music. I don't listen to it much, but I have this crazy theory that, and it's based on not only any studies or anything, that the state of popular music, because of these devices, there's a correlation in device use over the years and the quality of music going down because it's just something in the background while you're on these devices. So I was wondering, what's your opinion on that, or just the state of popular music right now? And also, did you foresee this rebirth of the vinyl?
Ooh.
So are you asking in terms of devices when you're recording music, or devices?
Oh, I'm sorry.
Playing music.
I'm sorry. I mean devices, as in just using an iPhone, just the.
Oh, know, right. iPad. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. You know. It still astonishes me, the sort of, there is so much music that is available. There's so much incredible music, and the internet, for all of its ill, all of its unexpected consequence of, hey, guess what? Every schmuck can have a voice. But that means that every schmuck can have a voice, you know. And yet every schmuck can have a band too, and every schmuck can record stuff and get it and make it available across the planet. So like, if you want to find quality music, you can find it. That's what's beautiful now. I do think there's always been a homogenization. Pop music tends to be this homogenization of styles. I think the homogenization that is currently sort of happening in pop isn't necessarily anything new. I think it's just... it's kind of atomic. The homogenization is fueled because much of the technology that is available across the board to everyone provides the same kind of sort of sonic palette, which that's the biggest bummer for me, is that there is a sameness in terms of the sonic. There's always been sameness in trends. You know, you listen to songs from the 70s, the drums sound a certain way. There's like a consistency in the way the drums sound, the guitars sound, the bass sound. It's like this. Oh, this is what the trend was at the time. You mute the toms, you mute everything. You just deaden all the sound as much as you can. 80s come along and you start getting drum machines and you get this like gated reverb thing that Phil Collins brings in. So all the drums sound gigantic and you get these big tom sounds and, oh, everybody starts using that. And then, you know, 90s kind of come in and then it's distorted guitars and everybody starts using distorted guitars because that's kind of the thing. You got to go back away from digital. We're going to go. So you have this homogenization that occurs. I think the problem is that the homogenization is so across the board now because everyone can get the same plugins and the same apps and the same devices, which is a wonderful thing because they're not super special anymore. But it also provides this... you know, I can hear a sample and I know where it's from. I know exactly like what app that's from or what drum machine or what download is being used for that particular sample. And so you just get a lot more examples of sameness. But there are tons of musicians that are doing really, really interesting, incredible, original stuff that isn't, you know, doesn't get the kind of coverage, but they might have their 1,000 fans, their 500 fans, their 10,000 fans, and you can find it and you can kind of enjoy it. I've strayed from your question, I think, and I'm sorry that I've strayed because I tend to do that.
It's okay. But, it's great what you're given there.
But your main question though was
just
yeah, we stated again.
it's like how do you feel about? I guess it's not. It's just I have this theory that, you know, because of the devices that we're using and being focused on that.
That's right. Okay. Yes. So that comes into it too. There's a thing called the loudness wars, which has started, and there of course is a response to that, and vinyl kind of enters into that as well. There is this idea that when you're producing music now, especially something that you want played on devices, because your music is coming out of a half-inch speaker or maybe a crappy headphone, you have to make it as loud as it can possibly be to have the impact to be louder than other devices. And so any kind of dynamic range gets squashed and gets eliminated. The most popular example of this was the Death Magnetic album that was done by Metallica. They released this record. It was compressed, which is, in essence, if you think of a waveform, like of a piece of music, if you compress it, you eliminate the highs and you eliminate the lows and you basically extend the middle so that the whole thing is just sort of loud the entire time, which is great for when you're playing it on the radio and you want it to stand out in your car, or you're playing it on a one-inch speaker and you want it to stand out from the other stuff that you're listening. But it loses that dynamic range. There has been a pushback against that. And so vinyl is part of that pushback, because you can't compress stuff to within an inch of its life on vinyl. It just doesn't work the same way that it does in an MP3 or an MP4 or any kind of digital media. So there is a pushback. I'm fascinated that vinyl has made this comeback. Vinyl, I think for the first time last year, made more. It cost more, or you know, earned more money than CDs, I think, for the first time. You know, it's because, you know, an album is now $23 or $25, so you're getting a much higher price point. But there are certain audiophiles that prefer that vinyl thing. My next album, which I'm going to have a vinyl version, which I never thought I would do a vinyl version. I haven't done any vinyl, but I'm going to do a vinyl version. My first album back in '93, I had a cassette of it, you know, as well as a CD, and then we stopped cassettes. I never thought I would do vinyl, but vinyl I'm going to do, because there is a definite market for it. And I think it's a bit of a pushback. So where it goes, where it ends up, I don't know. I think there is a diminishing returns kind of thing with pop music and trends. So I don't know. That's a whole other hour-long conversation about the music business and the mistakes that the industry has made over the last 25 years, 30 years, if not even 50 years. But I think there's a pushback, and the idea of boutique artistry can really expand itself and be something that can provide, you know, not the super glamorous lifestyle of rock intelligentsia or rock nobility, but you know, you can make $40,000 a year being a musician. You know what I mean? Like, you can have a life, you can have a nice place. And you can have a life because you have your 1,000 people that will buy two things a year. They're each going to spend, you know, 10 to 50 bucks a year on you. And that's the way to go. I think that's the real loveliness and the beauty and the future of what sort of the interwebs can provide.
Right. And you get to live out your dream, even though you're not, you know, making the millions, but you're still making, you know, enough to live on. And I just wanted to add one thing.
That's the thing.
Oh, sorry.
No, go for it. Yeah. Go for it.
Last thing, this is interest anybody that's interested in science, Jason, Chris, but I read an article, I think it was Rolling Stone years ago, Bob Dylan explained rock and roll. He said that the reason why we have rock and roll is because of the atomic bomb. Once you have that bomb, everything has to speed up. And I was like, oh, that was one of the coolest things. You know, I don't know. You know, it seems to make perfect sense to me, but whatever. Thanks. Thank you, George.
I'd love to read more about that. You've piqued my interest. Thanks, Ron.
No problem. Thanks, Jason.
I like the correlation between being bombed and fetish porn, because if you look at the strangest fetish porn comes from Japan and Germany, the two countries that we bombed almost out of existence in World War II. What's that about? That's interesting to me. Not that I partake necessarily, but just
that's very interesting.
if we're talking about bombing and the relationship of the nuclear arsenal and weaponry to not that we nuclear bombed Germany, but still Dresden was pretty much might as well have been a nuclear bomb.
Well, thanks for your question, Ron. My brain
goes. Sorry. Sorry, Ron.
It's okay.
It's all good. Okay. Paula has a question. Hi, Paula.
Hi, how you doing? How's everybody tonight? Hi, George.
Paula.
I'm really enjoying this. I have to tease you. You're a Catholic from Bethlehem, Pennsylvania.
Go figure, right?
Yeah, go figure, right? And you have those special stamps at your post office that say Bethlehem. See, so I know these
but
little things.
Not just that, but people actually come here during Christmas. I'm not from here originally. I'm from Jersey originally, but people come here at Christmas to get their Christmas cards canceled, and it says from the Christmas city. So they have a special line at the office during Christmas just for canceling your postage from the Christmas city. Isn't that wonderful?
I think it is. Hey, what the heck? But listen, I married a drummer, so I have to ask
you. Oh, my condolences.
Oh, no. That was like, you know, I liked Ringo best out of the Beatles. I don't know. I'm just into drummers. But I play guitar and piano, so, you know, I know. But anyway, we just kind of love that. But he loved like Buddy Rich and Gene Krupa and, you know, like in the Garden of Davida and Wipeout. He would play to all those as we were dating, you know, and just, I mean, it's hysterical. So my question to you is, who did you idolize? Did you have a drummer in mind, like, you know, like Buddy Rich or somebody, or did you just because your dad played? I mean, was there somebody like you were like, oh yeah,
no, sure. I mean, for me, the first real drummer, I mean, Stuart Copeland with the Police, I kind of got into because that was like you heard that on the radio, and that was kind of ubiquitous growing up in the 80s. So Stuart Copeland, who I think to this day I would say is probably still one of the most underrated in terms of his influence on 20th century drum set playing in a popular medium. Stuart Copeland, I think, is he's very popular and he's, you know, he's done brilliantly well, but all of the sort of hi-hat flourishes. And every time you hear a drummer do a little unexpected accent, that's all Stuart Copeland. So Stuart Copeland was kind of the first one. Neil Peart from Rush, because once I discovered that, I just dove into Rush, and I loved the fact that not only was Neil the drummer, but he was the lyricist. So it was like, oh, this is not Animal from the Muppets. This is a brilliantly intelligent person who is writing lyrics that are moving me, you know, more, almost more intensely than his drum playing. His lyrics, you know, any escape might help to prove the unattractive truth. The suburbs have no charms to soothe the restless dreams of youth. I mean, come on, the drummer wrote those words? Are you kidding me? That's fantastic. So that was a guy. And then once I got into Frank Zappa, it was a lot of the Zappa drummers. So Vinnie Colaiuta, Chad Wackerman, Terry Bozzio, those guys were just, as I was exploring Frank and kind of not doing my college coursework, but listening to Frank Zappa in the library, those guys just expanded the palette of what was possible. I had a bunch of Buddy Rich records, and I love big band, but the Buddy Rich persona always kind of turned me off. And there's the famous tapes of Buddy Rich yelling at his band, which my high school band director played for us, which was, you know, fun and giggly because he's cursing when you're a kid. But when you realize the kind of really hurt individual that was in that body, that kind of turned me off to a lot of what Buddy Rich did. And you know, obviously brilliant and an innovative player and wonderful. But once you hear him yelling at the band, to me, I was such a sort of innocent kid that really turned me off to Buddy Rich. I was like, why would you yell that much at the band? They're just playing. You know, it's very famous. I don't know if you ever heard the Buddy Rich tapes, like just Google, you know, Buddy Rich yelling at band.
I heard he had that kind of reputation. I just got one quick follow-up. Is there anybody you've famously played with that you played, you know, like a famous musician?
Oh my gosh. Well, I played a gig for Joan Rivers once. That was one of the best gigs I ever played. So get this, right? Joan Rivers is playing is doing her stand-up in Montclair, New Jersey. She's doing a thing at a show, and the piano player contractor for the band was a friend of mine, and she said, do you want to play this Joan Rivers gig? I said, what's involved? She said, you come to the gig, you play Anchors Away when she walks out, you sit on stage, you watch the show, and you play Anchors Away when she leaves. And I'll give you $300. And I'm like, yeah, are you kidding? So got to go, got to sit there. And Joan does this bit at the start of the show where she says, okay, you know, she's like, puts them in, she's like, okay, I'm going to say hit it and don't play. Like, you're supposed to play a drum roll when she walks up. Like, don't play a drum roll. I'm going to come out and I'm going to start yelling at you because you haven't played it. And I'm like, cool, great. So she's like off stage and like, you know, the thing, and she's like, hit it. Nothing. Hit it. It's like, can I curse, by the way?
Censor yourself. Okay, it's all good.
She's like, effing drummer, play. So then I finally played, and she goes in this whole bit. And there was another bit during the show where she's like, okay, I'm going to struggle with this plant. I'm going to try to move a plant out of the way. Like, no one help me. When I ask you for help, don't help me. So she's like, 40 minutes into the show, she does this bit, but like, there's a plant. She's trying to move the plant. She's like, can someone from the band please help me? We're all sitting there. Can someone from the freaking bit? It's brilliantly hilarious, making us all look like jerks, making her look like she's like over. It's all a bit. It's all prearranged, all done brilliantly. That was a really fun gig because it was just like, I got to see a Joan Rivers show and get paid for it, basically. That may be the most famous. I'm trying to think if there's another, you know, really sort of famous person. I mean, I got to open up for Elton John kind of years ago. We were at this a place in Philadelphia, the Kimmel Center. It was that first night it was opening up, and he was the headliner, but the band I was in, we had played sort of before him. So we always claimed that we opened up for Elton John, which was kind of nice. But
that's great. Yeah. Well, thank you very much. I really enjoyed this space, and you know, it's been really a lot of fun. Thank you so much.
Thanks for listening.
We're going to go to one more question. Jesse, do you have a question for George?
I did. Sorry, actually. So I'm someone who I always wanted to get into drumming growing up in school, but like a drum kit was crazy expensive. Do you have something you could recommend for like an adult who's like just trying to get, excuse me, I'm so sorry. I just had a big fat smoke there. But anyway, do you have something you recommend for somebody to get into it as an adult? Ideally, that's like kind of sort of electronic or compact.
Sure.
Even digital would be great.
Yeah. I didn't have a drum set for the first 9 years that I played. You know, I started lessons as a 7-year-old, and I didn't get a drum set until I was a junior in high school. So whatever that is, 14, 18, whatever. Yeah. I played on my bed for years and years and years and years and years. What I would recommend, unfortunately, a drum set is a bit of an investment. An electronic kit can also be a bit of an investment. What I would recommend is you get a practice pad. Now, a practice pad is like a sort of a wooden piece of, you know, just a piece of wood, which has this nice sort of rubbery top to it. And you get a pair of sticks and go find a local music store or a local music collective and go get a lesson with a human being. You can also do that online. You can get a lesson with a human being online. You can also check out a bunch of videos online and do that if you want to just start. But if you just want to start and just see if you're into it and see if you're interested and see if it's going to be something that you want to pursue for a while, for, you know, $20 and a pair of sticks and maybe one or two links to videos, you can kind of get a sense of, okay, this is how you hold the stick. This is how you hit with the stick. And here's a simple exercise. Try this out. What does this feel like? How does this feel? And then kind of take it from there. That's what I recommend. That way it's not this huge investment that ends up just being a coat hanger in the corner of your place if you're not into it.
Makes perfect sense. Thank you so much.
Awesome.
Jesse, great question. I see kids in high school, they practice on that with, they want to get into drums. They have to like do that first before.
Yes.
They have to like do the thing first before they get the drums. And yeah, of course it's, yeah, because they don't want to, you know, a school can't afford to have 100,000 drums. They, you know, only a few kids are going to have the stick with itness to get there. So,
yeah, I tell parents that too. I said, like, you know, like, yeah, it's great. You know, and a lot of parents want to buy the kid the drum kit, which is, you know, can be great too. It can be great to just dive right in. But if that's not financially an option, which, you know, it's not for everybody, although it's astounding. Again, talking about this homogenization idea, it's astounding how good musical equipment has gotten in the last, geez, 40 years. You know, the machine quality stuff, you know, stuff that used to be made in Mexico was always thought of being just junky and garbage. But you can get unbelievably good instruments now for not crazy amounts of money. And it all comes down to how you play it. You know, I always say that too. It's like, you don't need expensive equipment to sound to sound great. But you can get a drum set for, you know, not too crazy, but I still recommend, just to make sure that a kid or an individual, an adult, is going to be into it. Like, do you like holding the sticks? Do you like doing this? And what's great about drums is you can kind of do that by not necessarily with a simulacrum. It's much harder with guitar or clarinet or saxophone. There isn't really the equivalent.
You got to dive in on those things.
Yeah. You kind of have to, because that's it. There's no practice pad version of a sax, really. I mean, there are plastic instruments and stuff like that, but not quite the same. So, yeah, good question.
Yeah, keep them coming. All right. I think that's it. We have some folks listening on Clubhouse. Hey, I see you guys there. We have only a few people left on LinkedIn, but thank you for listening. I never know how many people are listening on Wisdom. It says 60, but we're not sure how many people are actually there. It's mysterious.
That's so Wisdom.
Yeah. Sherry DM'd me and she wanted to do something kind of at the end of the space, since you're a musician yourself. Sherry has a setup. Sherry, do you need me to fill some time before you're ready to do the thing?
No, I'm ready. I mean,
you're ready?
This is for George.
Yeah. Okay. Go ahead, Sherry.
I could use a drummer for this, but it's a little bit hard to collaborate over the internet. There's a time lag. But anyway.
Look, you can't afford me, Sherry. You can't afford me.
Well, if you do come to New Zealand, Australia, well, let's collaborate.
Absolutely.
So this is my favorite jazz pianist, Bill Evans, and I've been playing this number a few times on Space, and one of my favorite pieces, My Foolish Heart.
Oh, yay.
So good.
Thank you. I wish I had a double bass player too and a drummer. That would complete the set.
Were you playing that in A, or is it the internet weird that makes it drops at a half step?
Oh, it's A major. Yeah.
Okay. Because I always do that in B flat. I'm thinking, oh, that's interesting.
Oh, okay.
Cool.
I like this key.
Oh, lovely. Lovely. Thank you for that.
Thanks, Jerry. George, can you give some of the stuff that you do a plug? Where can people find anything and everything that you do as we wrap up tonight?
I always say this. What's fortunate about my last name is it's unique enough that if you Google me, you'll pretty much find everything. So my last name is Hrab, H-R-A-B. If you Google George Hrab, pretty much the first 68,000 things are me, which is kind of cool. But georgehrab.com. I have a podcast, the Geologic Podcast. Also, you know, on the YouTube, I have a YouTube channel. And on the Facebook and all stuff. But if you just literally Google Hrab on iTunes, all that stuff, it's unique. And I'm usually the first thing that pops up. So, yeah.
Awesome. Thank you, George. Just quickly as well, I want to give a shout out to our partner, Indra. Indra is in the space. She asked a question about the movie music. And up in the nest, we have Indra's space, which is happening, I believe that's tomorrow. It's a community space. Indra runs the Positivity Vibe Tribe, and she's the empathy mental health arm that we are very, very happy to partner with. So if you are all interested in joining a space to chat about mental health and being and positivity and centering yourself and all of that kind of awesome stuff, which is really important in today's busy life, make sure you check out Indra's space. Okay, George, any closing words before we shut her down? From me to you, thank you for agreeing to be the guest tonight. This was amazing.
Lugubrious. That's a good word. That's my closing word.
Lugubrious. I love it.
It's just a good word. A really good word. Not that this was lugubrious in any way, but that just popped in my head for some reason. So yes, that's my closing word. Thank you for having me. I really appreciate it. Thanks for doing stuff like this too. And kudos to the international audience, man. I tell you, again, for all of the ills that the interwebs have introduced into our existence, this is one of those lovely, lovely, lovely things that we need to embrace more.
We've got everybody here that could possibly listen on different continents. It's very, very cool. The unfortunately, folks in Europe and parts of, I guess Europe, they're all asleep. Europe and England, they're all asleep. But we got, time zones. I have to say, before we shut down, one thing, I never thought in a space that I would be hosting about non-nerdy topics would both Scott Pilgrim and Guardians of the Galaxy and Dragon Con all come up in the same space. So this has been a highlight for the nerd inside me. So thank you as well, George.
You are more than welcome. And that's what happens when you chat with me.
That's awesome.
I've never heard the words Dragon Con before right now, but it sounds awesome.
It's a big cosplay event in the States. It's a Comic-Con. Is that right, George? It's more than that, it's more than that.
Yeah, I mean, it's in Atlanta.
Yeah.
I think it's like 50,000, 60,000 people. And it's all media. So it's not just science fiction. It's not just movies. It's media.
Yeah.
So it's music. It's movies. It's, again, you know, there's a NASA track. There's a science track. There's you just everything there. And it's like five hotels all interconnected. And it's wonderful.
Yeah. We keep getting bugged to go down there by some of the cosplay friends that we know. So maybe one of these years. My Groot suit does not fit on a plane, though. That's the only problem. It would definitely be oversized.
Okay.
So the last thing I'm going to say, George, is we have this really big science communication account on Twitter. If you ever need something augmented, just tag us or send me a DM. I know Twitter maybe isn't your platform of preference, but we're here and we're willing to help.
No. Yeah, I try to tweet as much as I can. So thank you. Yeah, that's great. That's great. Maybe when the new record comes out.
Yeah, you bet. Give it absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely.
Oh, I should also say, you know, this weekend I have this Nexus conference, which is happening, which is a virtual thing. I should have mentioned that up front.
I put it up in the nest.
Yeah. That's going to be a wonderful. I got a chance to talk to, you know, David Copperfield and Bill Nye. I interviewed them. And that was a really wonderful, my 12-year-old self couldn't believe that I was talking to David Copperfield. So that was pretty cool. It's going to be a really interesting conference. It's a very different kind of conference, especially for a, you know, for what purports to be a skeptic conference. Those tend to have the same kinds of speakers. We really went out of our way. The board went out of its way to really get some different and interesting speakers for the Saturday, you know, social psychologists and a sports therapist that's going to talk about, you know, BS sports stuff that's on the web. Like, it's going to be really
like
interesting.
Yeah. Like cupping?
like all of it, you know, cupping, just even general, you know, like, you know, ginkgo biloba and all that horse pucky about therapeutics and especially as related to sports, which I think, you know, I've never seen someone present that kind of a thing mm-hmm. before. So I'm excited for that.
It's a huge industry and not all of it is good for you, right?
Huge.
So, yeah.
Most of it's not. Most of it is just nonsense. It's a shame. Most of it is just water. It's a different kind of homeopathy. It's all just nonsense.
Yeah. Nexus is all.
You can do whatever you want.
Nexus is all. Is it all recorded, right? Like if you buy a ticket, you have X amount of time to watch it, or is some of it live?
3 months. You have 3 months to watch.
Okay. Yeah, all right.
We run it live. But if you do buy a ticket, it gives you a pass. I think it's like right. 2 or 3 months you can watch it at your convenience. And it's well worth it.
Okay. I was listening to the SGU a couple of days ago, and I might have got that garbled. So thanks for clarifying there.
For sure. For sure.
Okay. As we wrap up tonight, thanks again to our guest today, George Hrab. Hilarious, informative, and deep today. Great conversation, George.
Handsome. Hello.
And handsome. That's right. Talented. I can keep going. I'm going to run out of my ending music, though.
I'm kidding. Oh my God, thank you. No, this has been really wonderful. Like, and keep doing what you're doing.
Thank you.
This is the stuff that changes the world. This is like the stuff that changes the world. So good for you.
We're just a cog, and we're happy to spin the wheel. But thank you. Thanks to all of the speakers who came up to chat tonight. I appreciate everybody listening also on the other platforms. Thanks to the Clubhouse, LinkedIn, and Wisdom folks that are listening, and to the huge Twitter crew. Thank you. You could be anywhere in the world tonight, but you're listening to our science show. And we all get a little better when we think a little bit more critically about how we consume media. Okay, Chris, any final words? I don't even know. Are you home? Are you getting
Adam? I'm home.
Oh, you're home. You're back from getting Adam. Okay.
Hey, honey, I'm home.
Oh, my God. Okay.
And I dropped the kids. Just kidding.
Okay.
Thanks for holding the space, George. This was fantastic and so informative. I was enthralled the entire time. I appreciate
Yay.
It. Thank you.
Very sweet. Thank you.
Chris is my wife and the co-host, but she had to go get our son. So she was like, she was not here for some of it. You were listening while you were driving, I think. Something.
Yeah, 100%. I was listening while I was driving and it didn't cut out. So this was great.
A couple things. Please check the nest for Indra's space that's happening tomorrow. We're having... You'll